Hello everybody. Lifespan development. Under this, today we are dealing with the lesson prenatal period. The objective of this lesson is to help to understand the prenatal stages, to be familiar with the hazards in the prenatal development, and to be able to describe the birth process and the types of birth, and to understand that the complication that can happen during the delivery. Prenatal development is a process by which a baby develops inside the mother's womb. Prenatal development takes about 38 weeks to complete. During this time, a single cell becomes a full-term baby. This time period can be divided into different categories of development. Conception occurs when a single sperm cell from the male unites with a ovum or egg in the female's fallopian tube, which is called as a fertilization. Over the next few months, the genetic code directs a series of changes in the fertilized egg, but many events and hazards will influence how that the egg develops and becomes a person. The prenatal development may last approximately for 266 days, beginning with fertilization and ends with the birth. It can be divided into three periods: the germinal, the embryonic, and the fetal stages. An especially important and fascinating aspect of the prenatal period is the development of the brain. Now, first we will see the first stage of this prenatal period, that is the germinal period. The germinal period is the period of prenatal development that takes place in the first 2 weeks after the conception. It includes the creation of fertilized egg, which is called as a zygote. Cell division and attachment of the zygote to the uterine wall takes place during this period. The rapid cell division by the zygote begins the germinal period. So, the cell division takes place by mitosis. Approximately 1 week after the conception, the differentiation of these cells, their specialization for different tasks will begin with the prenatal period. The germinal stage is the stage of the development that occurs from conception until 2 weeks, that is until the implantation takes place. During the germinal stage, the cells necessary for the placenta, the umbilical cord and the amniotic fluid will differentiate to form the embryo. The mass of the cells has yet to attach itself to the lining of the uterus. Once this attachment occurs, the next stage will begin. The next stage is the embryonic period. The embryonic period is the period of prenatal development that occurs from 2 to 8 weeks after conception. During the embryonic period, the rate of cell differentiation intensifies and the support system for the cell form and organ also begin to appear. This period begins as the blastocyst attaches to the uterine wall. The mass of the cells is now called as the embryo, and three layers of cells form. The embryo's endoderm is the inner layer of the cell, which develops into the digestive system and respiratory system. And the next layer is the ectoderm, which is the outermost layer, which becomes into nervous system and the sensory receptors. The sensory receptors are the ears, nose and eyes, and the skin. Then the next layer of the cells is the mesoderm, which is the middle layer, which will become the circulatory system, the bones, the muscles, excretory system and the reproductive system. Every body part eventually develops from these three basic layers. The endoderm primarily produces the internal body parts. The mesoderm primarily produces the parts that surrounds the internal areas, and the ectoderm, it produces the surface parts. As the embryo, three layers form, the life support systems for the embryo develop rapidly. These life support system will include the amnion, the umbilical cord, which develops from the fertilized egg, and then the placenta. The amnion is like a bag or an envelope, and it contains a clear fluid in which the developing embryo will float. The amniotic fluid provides an environment. The environment means the temperature, humidity controlled, as well as the shock proof. An umbilical cord contains two arteries and one vein. It connects the baby to the placenta. The placenta consists of a disc-shaped group of tissues in which the small blood vessels from the mother and the offspring and the baby intertwine, but they do not join. Then after the germinal stage and the embryonic stage, let us now see the fetal stage. The fetal stage is the remainder of the prenatal development, occurs during the fetal stage, which lasts from the 9 week to the birth. When the organism is about of 9 weeks old, the embryo will be called as a fetus. At this stage, the fetus is about the size of a kidney bean and begins to take a recognizable form of a human being. Between the 9 to 12 weeks, the reflexes begin to appear and the arms and legs start to move. This is about the 3 stages of the prenatal period. After having understood what is prenatal period and what are the different stages and what happens during each stage of the prenatal period, let us now move on to see what are the hazards to the prenatal development. Mother's womb protects most of the babies as they are developing. Despite this protection, the environment can affect the embryo or the fetus in many well documented ways. Let us see what are these ill effects to the embryo or the fetus. Drug use. Teratogen is an agent that can potentially cause a birth defect or negatively alter the cognitive and behavioral outcomes. The field of study that investigates the causes of the birth defect is called as teratology. Some of the exposures to teratogens do not cause the birth defects, but they can alter the developing brain and influence the cognitive and behavioral functioning of that child, in which a case of a field study called as behavioral teratology. Then the next hazard is the incompatible blood type. Incompatibility between the mother's and father's blood type poses another risk to the prenatal development. The blood types are created by differences in the surface structure of these red blood cells. One type of the differences in the surface of the red blood cells creates a familial blood groups, that is A, B, O and AB. A second difference creates what is called as the Rh positive and Rh negative blood. If a surface maker called the Rh factor is present in an individual's red blood cells, the person is said to be Rh positive. If the Rh marker is not present, then the person is said to be Rh negative. If a pregnant woman is Rh negative and her partner is Rh positive, the fetus may have a Rh positive. If the fetus blood is Rh positive and the mother's is Rh negative, the mother's immune system may produce antibodies which will attack the fetus. So, it is a hazard for the fetus. Then the next important complication is the maternal diseases and infections. Maternal diseases and infections can produce defects in the offsprings by crossing the placental barrier, or they can cause damage during the birth. For example, rubella, which is the German measles, one of the diseases that can cause prenatal defects. Women who plan to have children should have a blood test before they become pregnant to determine if they are immune to the disease or not. Then the next important hazard to the prenatal development is the maternal diet and nutrition. A developing embryo or fetus depends completely on its mother's further nutrition, which comes from the mother's blood. The nutritional status of the embryo or the fetus is determined by the mother's total calorie intake, including her intake of proteins, vitamins and minerals. Children born to malnourished mothers are more likely than the other children to be malformed. Then the next important complication that may occur is because of the emotional state and stress. When a pregnant woman experiences intense fears, anxieties and other emotions, the physiological changes can occur which may affect the fetus. For example, producing adrenaline in response to the fear restricts the blood flow to the uterine area and can deprive the fetus of adequate oxygen, which can affect the fetus during the prenatal development. Then the next important one is the maternal age. Maternal age is also have a link to the risk that the child will have a Down syndrome, which is a form of mental retardation, which has been already discussed. A baby with Down syndrome is rarely born to a mother who is of below her age, that is 16 years, or to a mother of above age, that is around 40 years. When the mother reaches 40 years of age, the probability of having a child with Down syndrome is more likely to happen. Then next comes the environmental hazards. Some specific hazards to the embryo or the fetus includes the radiation, the toxic waste and other chemical pollutants. Among the dangerous pollutants are the carbon monoxide, the mercury and lead, as well as certain fertilizers and also pesticides. So these are some of the common hazards that can happen during the prenatal development. As we already know, this is the first developmental period in the lifespan. Though the period is very short, it is in many respects one of the most important period. It begins with conception and ends at birth, approximately 270 to 280 days in length, or the calendar of 9 months. Although it is relatively very short, it has 6 important characteristics, each of which has a lasting effect on the development during the lifespan. Let us see what are the 6 important characteristics during the prenatal period or prenatal development. The first one is the hereditary endowment. Hereditary endowment, which serves as a foundation for later development, is fixed once for all at this stage of development. While favorable or unfavorable conditions both before and after birth may and probably will affect to some extent the physical and psychological traits that make up this hereditary endowment, that changes will be quantitative and not qualitative. The favorable conditions in the mother's body can foster the development of heredity potentials, while unfavorable condition can stunt their development. The sex of the newly created individual is fixed at the times of conception, and conditions with the mother's body will not going to affect it. Proportionally greater growth and development takes place during the prenatal period than at any other time throughout the individual's entire life. During these 9 months, the individual grows from microscopically small cell to an infant who measures approximately 20 inches in length and weighs an average of 3 to 3.5 kgs. So we can say that the development is very rapid during this period. And prenatal period is a time for many hazards, both physical and psychological. This can have a marked effect on the pattern for later development, or may even bring the development to an end. How the life begins? The new life begins with the fertilization of the egg. There are 23 pairs of chromosomes in each sexual cell, and each chromosome contains genes which carries the heredity or endowment or the heredity information. At the time of conception, 4 important conditions are determined that influence the individual's later development. These are the important characteristics during the prenatal period or prenatal development which influences the human being's later development. In the birth process, the first one is the labor. It is the process by which the baby and placenta are expelled through the birth canal. Labor involves the muscular contractions of the uterus to aid the infant in moving through the birth canal. Contractions. Contractions are the means through which the labor and delivery can occur. They are the movements of the uterus by means of which the cervix is opened and the baby is delivered. The real labor is characterized by the onset of the contractions which have a definite rhythm. For example, the contractions may be 15 to 20 minutes apart during the early phase of labor, which may last to 40 to 45 seconds. Now we will see what are the stages in labor. The first stage is the stage of dilation. The first stage involves the thinning and widening of the cervix. Cervix is the opening of the uterus at the end of vaginal canal and is composed of the muscles and fibrous tissue. Before the onset of labor, the cervix is very thick and narrow, measuring only less than 2 cm in diameter. With the onset of the contractions, the cervix thins and widens to 10 cm to allow the baby to pass through. The contractions come close together as the cervix dilates. Then the next stage is the stage of expulsion. The second stage of labor begins when the cervix is completely dilated to 10 cm and ends when the child is born. At this time, the contractions are usually 60 to 70 seconds in duration of 2 to 3 minutes apart. With each contraction, the baby moves further down to the birth canal. Just prior to delivery, the woman may be given an anesthesia to ease of her pain. Another common procedure at this time is episiotomy or incision to enlarge the vagina. The actual birth of the baby occurs rather quickly after the widest part of the infant head becomes visible. Once the baby's head is delivered, even before the infant body is born, the physician begins the suction of the mucus from the baby's mouth and nose. Sometimes the physician taps or rubs the soles of the baby's feet or buttock in order to get the infant to take the oxygen in. As the baby begins to exhale, it begins to cry. Once the baby is free of the birth canal, then the cord is allowed to stop pulsating before it is clamped and cut so that the baby receives the remaining support in the cord. The vernix, a cheesy film which covers the baby's skin, is wiped off. Silver nitrate drops are administered into each of the eyes of the infant to prevent any type of infection and possible blindness. The baby is then usually maintained in a slightly head down position. This position will help the mucus drainage and also will aid in respiration. The last stage is the third stage of the delivery. The third stage of the delivery is the delivery of the placenta. There is seldom any pain associated with the expulsion of the placenta after the birth. The episiotomy is regained at this time. The new mother is allowed to see and hold her baby, and she may even be able to nurse the baby. This is about the birth process, which includes the labor and contraction and how the baby is delivered. The different types of birth are the normal birth. In normal birth, the position of the fetus and its size is suitable to the size of mother's reproductive organs, and the dilation occurs adequately and the head emerges first, followed by the rest of the body. Then the next type of delivery or the next type of birth is forceps delivery. In the second stage of labor, though the mother has severe pains, the baby is not able to come out, then the baby's heartbeat may slow down. In such cases, the head will be pulled very carefully with the help of the forceps. This type of delivery is called as the forceps delivery. Sometimes damage may also occur, and this may result in birth defects if the forceps delivery is not done very carefully. Then the next type of the birth is the cesarean delivery. It is a surgical procedure through which the baby is delivered. In a cesarean birth, the physician makes an incision through the abdominal wall and uterus. The infant is removed and then the incision is carefully seamed up. The next one is the breech presentation. In this, the process, the buttocks or the legs emerges first instead of the head. Birth becomes difficult and dangerous. The next one is the transverse presentation. In this process, the shoulder and the arms emerge first instead of the head. Birth becomes difficult and dangerous, and cesarean delivery will becoming a necessity. Then the next one is the induced labor or overdue birth. When spontaneous labor does not occur at the expected time, then the delivery is induced either by puncturing the bag of water or by injecting medicines or hormones to get the uterine contractions going. This type of delivery is called as the induced labor. So these are the different types of the birth process. After having understood what are the stages in the birth process and what are the types of the deliveries, now let us move on to see what are the complications that can occur and affect the infant during the delivery. Let us now see some of the complications that can happen during the delivery which has effect on the infant. Anoxia. Anoxia is a condition where the infant is deprived of the oxygen supply or retention of the carbon dioxide during the birth process. Anoxia may occur if the umbilical cord becomes damaged or knotted or squeezed or shut or detached due to the abnormalities in the mother and conditions during the labor. Severe anoxia may result in brain damage of the infant, or the functional defects or cerebral palsy or mental retardation, or sometimes even death can also occur to the infant. Then the next important complication is the postpartum hemorrhage, that is the excessive and dangerous loss of blood after the childbirth is called as postpartum hemorrhage. Next one is the antepartum hemorrhage. Any bleeding that occurs from vagina during the pregnancy, if it occurs during the first 3 months, usually it is due to the threatened abortion or maybe due to the placental detachment after the birth. Then the next one is the postpartum depression. This is emotional disturbances experienced by some women after delivery, that is intense feeling of sadness, anxiety, despair experienced by the mother after the delivery. Some temporary tiredness and depression following the physical and emotional stress, but it may disappear in few days. If this is profound, medication might become necessary. Then the next one is the infections. During the childbirth, the bleeding wall of the uterus and any other torn areas can be exposed to germs. This may cause a serious infection and may also cause death. This can be controlled by using sterile techniques during the delivery. Then the next one is the birth injuries and birth defects. Head injuries may occur due to prolonged delivery or difficulties during the delivery. Injury to the nerves branching from the spinal cord may cause paralysis of the arms and legs. Birth defects or the abnormalities present at birth are known as the congenital defects. They may inherit from the parents due to illness or toxic conditions in the uterus or the birth passage. Mongolism, cleft palate, color blindness, hemophilia, congenital heart diseases are some of the common birth defects. Cerebral palsy, mental retardation may also occur because of deprivation of oxygen or because of detachment of placenta after birth of the baby or twisting of the umbilical cord can also cause mental retardation or cerebral palsy to the child. These are some of the complications that can occur during or after delivery. So, today we have learned the importance and the characteristics of the prenatal period. We have understood what are the three important stages that happen in the prenatal development. We also have seen and understood the birth process, the types of deliveries and the complications that can have or happen to the child during the process of the delivery. So, we have understood that the birth process is an important milestone in the life of a mother as well as a child. If proper medical supervision is available, this process leads to birth of a healthy child and healthy recovery for the mother. However, if the medical supervision or at least experienced person supervision is missing, many birth complications leading to birth defects and the abnormalities in the child will happen and it may result have the development of the child. Hope you have understood the lesson. Thank you.